Today's show is pre-recorded.
Y'all know what time it is.
Y'all don't know, y'all better ask somebody.
Hat on,
suit on,
looking
like the dapper dawn,
giving a microphone,
dress
like the $1 million,
buttons,
things in its cuffs.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all tell me, who could it be but Steve Harvey?
Oh, yeah.
Everybody out there listening to me.
Put your hands together
for Steve Harvey.
Put your hands together.
I sure will. Good morning, everybody. You are listening to The Voice. Come on, dig me now. One and only Steve Harvey. Man, got a radio show. Steve Harvey got a radio show because God in the blessing business. Yeah. That's all. I'm just a recipient. Steve Harvey got a radio show because God is in the show you favor business. He showed me some favor. Steve Harvey got a radio show because God is in the forgiving business. God done forgave me thousands and thousands of times. You know, and I say that as a big number like that because it's probably true. God is a forgiving God. That's how I exist today. And that's how you exist today. And one of the things I want to remind you about even in existing today, you know, Joel Osteen has a book out called It's Your Time. I love this book. It's called It's Your Time. And that's kind of what I want to touch on today. And I want to remind you all that it's still your time. See, you know, they've got unsuccessful people have created a lot of sayings to justify our failures as people. Well, my ship has passed. That was created by a person who did not quite make their goal in the amount of time that they had set for. So to justify it, here comes this great, seemingly very clever saying, and a lot of us adopt. Well, my ship has passed. So we adopt that. Here's another one. Well, I guess it just wasn't meant to be. That sounds good, don't it? Because they mix it up with a little bit of faith base in it. I guess it wasn't. Well, here's another one. I guess if God wanted it for me, I'd have it. Are you serious, man? Are you serious? You're actually going to use that one to justify where you are in life, man? That's so not the case. I want to remind everybody today that it's still your time. That, you know, your ship hasn't sailed. You didn't miss all of your opportunities. There's others. It's still your time. You know, you still got a chance. You still have a shot. Here's a good one. You still have hope. You do. All of you. As long as God is who he is, There's always hope for you. You can never lose sight of that. You can never let the devil win that battle, that there is no hope for you, and cause you to do something that's unthinkable. I'm just going to cash in the chips. I'm going to take my life. I'm going to commit suicide. No. Wait a second. Are you for real? That's not God talking to you. That's something wrong, and it's not coming from him. It's still your time. You still got a chance. There's always hope. But listen to me. You got to move, and you got to move on it. So many people are not getting the full benefit of their life, and so many people are not getting all the blessings that God has for them because you keep waiting on the perfect time. Man, how many times have I heard people come to me and say, hey, man, I'm just waiting on everything to line up right, man. I'm waiting on the perfect time to get, hey, can I tell you something? If I were waiting on the perfect time, I wouldn't be hardly any of the things that I've become. And one of my greatest blessings was marrying Marjorie. I wouldn't even have married Marjorie if I was waiting on the perfect time, because I had gone through what I thought was enough misery to cover my entire lifetime. And so when I was first divorced, I just said, man, it's going to be 5-6 years before I do this again. I said it. 2 years later, I was married. But guess what, man? It wasn't the perfect time. I didn't have all my ducks lined up in a row. It was still some things I needed to clean up. I even told her, it's some things I want to clean up out of my life before. You know, I want to make sure I got all the stars aligned up. You know, I want to wait until all the ducks are in a row. I was waiting on the perfect time. If I had not stopped and Marjorie and I had set out and said to each other, there'll be no perfect time. And then she said, I'll go through with you whatever you're going through. That was it. I took a chance. The ducks were not lined up in a row. I had a lot of baggage in my life, man. I wanted to try to clear up. I wanted to do some things financially different. I wanted to just get rid of some residue I had in my life. She said, no, we'll do it together because there ain't no perfect time. And guess what? It wasn't. So if you're out there waiting on the perfect time to do something, it may not come. There is no such thing as waiting on the perfect time. I've said this 100 times and here comes 101. The road to success is always under construction. You ain't finna go out there and there ain't no barrels on the road. You're not going out there and not running to detour signs. You're not going out there without seeing the men working sign, the get off. You're not going out there to see it. So guess what? Stop waiting on the stars. Man, this is the perfect time to do it now. If you're waiting on the perfect time, that could be one of your biggest problems. You're still waiting. You have got to move, and you've got to move on it, and you've got to make a decision to go now. God will get you through everything necessary for you to get through. But you can't quit, though. See, here's a part. You can't quit. Just because the road you're on is under construction, you can't get off at the exit because you're tired of all the bumper-to-bumper traffic. It's that way. Get you some God, like I said, get you some God, and go on and go see what your life can be like. So stop waiting on the perfect time. Stop waiting on the stars to align themselves. You got to move, and you got to move on it. Get you some God, apply some faith, and get started. And remember, when you get out there coming towards your goal, the road to success is always under construction. If it was easy, everybody would be it. Stop expecting it to be easy. Come on out here. Get up in this thing. It's funky out here. Yeah, I got all that. It's hard out here. Yeah, I got all that. But what you want to do, man? Huh? What you want to do? You want to push your chips up to the window? It ain't time for that. You still got time. You still got a chance. There's always hope. There's always God. That's my conversation today.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
Ladies and gentlemen, you know what it is. It's a new day. And we started the same way every day, man. And today is a special day. Because today is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the one we got. Yesterday gone, tomorrow ain't promised. This is the one we dealing with. So since this is it, this is the one you got, let's get to getting after it, man. Let's be glad about it. Get your tooed up. Get your tooed up. I start this day like I do every day with gratitude, which then affects my attitude, which has a direct correlation to my altitude. Without one, you can't have the other, and without the other, you need the other one. What I'm saying here is gratitude affects your altitude, which directly is in correlation with your altitude. If you ain't flying high as you want, altitude-wise, I bet your attitude is the reason why you're not there. And the reason why your attitude ain't there is probably because you're showing a lack of gratitude. They all go hand in hand. Or if you think your attitude ain't right, it's probably because you ain't grateful for the stuff you have, so you can't even see what God done for you. So now you steady on the ass tip when you don't even realize you got a lot to be grateful for. So why would he give you more? If God is a just God now, why would he give you more to be grateful for if you ain't grateful for what you have? He ain't going to overburden you with that now. You better get to being grateful. Ladies and gentlemen, Steve Harvey Morning Show, Shirley Strawberry, the mouth of the South, Mississippi Monica, Junior, Kill Spates, yes. The legend that is Nephew Tommy. Junior, what?
I'm going to tell you this, Unc. Let me ask you this, Unc. You know, man, it's Mentoring Camp weekend. You know, it's Mentoring Camp weekend, Unc. You said, man, if I want to change it, I got to up the number. You said I got to help more boys. And so, therefore, you didn't even see you had the means. Now you got the ranch that you just bought. Now you over here doing more. Is this the process that you just asked for and it show up? You just keep doing it?
Well, faith without works is dead. You can ask for a lot of stuff, but if you ain't willing to do the things that can make it happen, what you keep asking God for? Dear God, give me a job. But you sitting at the house ain't filling out no applications. You ain't doing no interviews. You ain't went on a headhunter. You ain't on none of the sites for a job. But you steady at the house asking God for a job. But you ain't done no work. That's all it is, man. I'm just a byproduct of when hard work and faith come together, some amazing things can happen in your life. But the key to this whole thing is faith. And yeah, I ask because, and then when I ask, he do more though. See, he does exceedingly and abundantly over all right. I think or ask. Can I tell you something? Everything I've ever asked for that took a long time to get, when I got it, it was way more than I thought it was going to be.
Look at God.
Man, I'm tell you something, man. Hey, God, I serve.
Come on, Harvey.
That God I serve, you can't tell me nothing about him. I don't even hear you. Matter of fact, boy, you're going to mess around and find out what type of Christian I really am. If say something to me about it. Okay. All right. Don't do
God
it.
God says go, Steve. Coming up at 32 minutes after the hour, we'll hear from the nephew and run that prank back right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
All right, it is time now to start your morning off with the nephew and run that prank back. What you got for us, Neff?
Okay, your please. Wife is in the limo. Let's go, cat dog. Your wife is in the limo.
Hello?
Hello, I'm trying to reach Robert.
Yeah, what's happening? This Robert. What's up, boss?
Hey, how you doing? Hey, listen, man. My name's Phil, dog. I know you threw some other people. Your brother's right?
Yeah, that's my brother. Yeah, what's happening?
Listen, man, I'm calling you because there's something going
hold on.
Right?
Hold on, first of all, everything all right with my brother, right? This ain't no trouble, is it?
No.
Okay.
Straight, man. Listen, though. You married to right?
Yeah, that's my wife, boss.
Okay. Well, see, man, what I'm trying
to... Look, man. Spit it out. What's happening, boss?
Listen, what I'm trying to explain to you. My name for you.
Okay.
Part-time, I drive limos. And I'm actually driving right now.
Okay. But, okay, what's up?
Well, I had seen your wife. You know, I knew you was little brother. you know, I was like, okay, this right here ain't cool.
Hold on, bro. You know, you seen my wife? What you mean, my wife? How you know? What you talking about?
Okay, well, okay, Rob, let me ask you, is your wife there right now?
No, boss, my wife been gone, man. She was out with her sister and her homegirls, man. They been gone. What are you trying to get at, man? What's my
okay,
brother?
Okay, bro, listen. Okay, I got, hey, I understand. Just listen to me, man. Listen. Hey, man, I done been dogged out a many times by some ladies, you know what I'm saying? I just hate to see brothers get done wrong. I don't like
wrong.
This.
Where are you coming from, dog? Listen, dog, you need to go ahead and just spit out all this rambling and
Okay, listen, man.
I drive
limousine. And what I'm trying to say to you is
what you trying to say, man? Spit it out.
Your wife is in the back of the limousine I'm driving right now.
She in the back, so what? What, the girls out and like that?
No,
what? They
no,
out
no, man. If it was a bunch of girls out, I wouldn't even be calling you, bro. Your wife is in the back of this limousine with a man.
What the man? What the man? Oh, my
okay.
God. Hey, Junior, y'all step out of the room for a minute, man. Step out of the room for a minute. Step out of the room. Just, hold on, boss. Step out of the room for a minute, man. Step out of the room. Hello, Sid?
Yeah, man. Yeah.
Hey, look, man. You need to come correct, man, because this ain't no matter right here, dog. You saying that my wife, you got my wife in the back of the limousine you driving.
Man.
What she got on, dog? What she got on? What color it is that she got on?
A black dress with white lines in it.
What
that's
the where you at,
man? Hey, bro, I'm trying to make sure I got the right person.
Okay, look.
That what she had on?
You know my brother. You ain't got that accomplice. And you saying that you got my wife when what she is out the house with talking about, does this look cute? Does this look, I wouldn't stand this look cute. And you saying he in the back of your car? Where you driving at, dog? Where you driving at, man? That's all I need to know about. You need to have that with whoever it is.
Okay, dog, listen, man. Well, I'm trying to say this to you. See, dog, I've been on this road here myself, man. You know what I'm
look,
saying?
Look, dog, just tell me this, man.
Reach out to you,
it's,
man.
It's the wrong that's sitting in the back. Do she got the curls coming down on the side? That's all I need to know. Do she got the curls that's dangling on the side?
Yeah.
I ain't hear you, boss. I hear you. Speak up, man.
I said, yeah, man. I can't talk loud, man. They in the back.
Hey, look, all this man, you calling me, dog, and this some serious you gonna call and you try to make it straight, right? So you bring it all over to where I'm at, boss.
Dog, I can't do that, man. I can't bring him
what
over
the
there.
You can't do that, dog.
You're gonna,
hey,
you gonna,
look,
act,
look,
you gonna act crazy,
see,
bro.
See,
you gonna act
see,
crazy,
see,
man.
See,
I'm
see, what color you lay in? Look, dog, you call me, put her on the phone. That. Put her on the phone.
I can't.
Get a phone to her, dog. Get a phone. Obey that. You need to drive that where I'm at, boss. Drive that where I'm at, boss, because this is going to be handled right now. I just got it's another year. I said I'm going to go back to my old
Hold up. Damn, they kissed it.
Man, I can't hear you, dog. You listen, all this whispering and you either need to stop this car and say you need to or some stand outside the car and tell me where the hell you at. I can come meet you wherever the hell you at, dog. Or you need to bust that around and tell her that you got to take a detour or some dog, because this
okay, hey, dog, you got to calm down, man.
Hold the dog. You don't even know me, man. You ain't mess with the wrong dog. So listen, boss. Here's the thing, boss. Look, I'm either going to find out what limousine service the rest of you drive, and I'm going to find your or you're going to have to come find me, dog. You ain't mess with the wrong one. Put on the phone, boss. Put on the phone.
Hey, dog.
Hey, put on the phone, man. I ain't got time to be. Hey, look. Hey, you help me out. Appreciate the call, man. Put on the phone, man.
Wait. Rob.
What's up, man?
Okay, listen.
Man, you think this a game? Man, I'm finna come find. Hey, dog.
Okay, do you want? I'm gonna give you the address on where they finna go.
Listen. Hey, man.
Dog. All I know is they gonna stop at the hotel for a minute, man. It's chain club.
Hotel. What the? This is playing. Hey, look. Hey, where you at right now, dog? You that. I'm on my way. I'm on my way. What hotel, dog?
Oh, come on, man. Don't act like that.
Dog, where she at? Where you at,
dog? Don't act like that, man.
Hey, look, you got one more time to be trying to tell me how to act.
Okay, I'm finna tell you, man, but listen to me. I want to tell you one more thing.
Man, what the f***? I ain't got time for no more one more thing. The one more thing you need to be telling me is where you at, dog? Where you at, man?
This is Nephew Tommy from the Steve Harvey Morning Show. You just got pranked by your wife.
Hell no. Hey, man. Man. What the? Nephew Tommy.
This is Nephew Tommy in the flesh, baby.
Man, am I on the radio? Man. God. My bad, cousin, dog. My bad, man. You got me, man. You got me, man. Golly.
Hey, let me ask you something,
man.
Before we go, Rob, what is, man, the baddest radio show in the
world? Oh, man, the Steve Harvey Morning Show with Nephew Tommy is crazy.
All right, we'll be back with more of the Steve Harvey Morning Show right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
It is time now for Ask the CLO, Chief Love Officer, Steve Harvey. We have some good questions from SteveHarveyFM.com. Keep them coming, people. Keep them coming. This one is from Nikki in Dayton, Ohio, Steve.
Dayo, baby.
Yeah,
Patterson. Patterson Co-op. And Wilbur Wright Air Force Base, very familiar down there. Dayton Comedy Club used to be there too. Go ahead, Sean.
All right. It says, Nikki says, I'm a 37-year-old woman, and my father hooked me up with a decent man, and I've been dating him for 7 months. He works hard, and he is a great man, but he's not the one for me. We started having sex a month ago, and there were no sparks at all. I know that this is the type of man I should be with, but I prefer a street-savvy guy with a little edge to him. Great in the bed, but still loves the Lord. What's wrong with me? Do you think I'm going to miss out on a good thing because of what I prefer in a man?
Come you on, want CLO. Street-savvy, edge, and love the Lord.
Right. Yeah,
okay.
That's so great in bed.
Okay. Let me get it right. You want street savvy, edge, love the Lord, and great in bed.
Check.
Right.
Check.
But I'm assuming you have a great man who just for you ain't great in bed.
Yeah, pretty much. That's
y'all could work on the sex part, but you 37, so you gonna pass on this man because y'all could have better sex? And it could happen. So I would reconsider, because I don't know how long you've been out there on this grind looking for this man, this good man and all this here. But if you want to get back out there and see what else is out there, go ahead. But there are a lot of people on this on that's listening that would tell you to work on that first. You've been with him 7 months. I'd put some effort into seeing if y'all can't straighten out this sexual problem first.
Yeah.
Before you go throwing this good man back in the trash. Yeah.
What's she going to tell her daddy why they broke up?
Well, daddy, you know, I liked him and everything. You know, like, he was everything you said he was. But damn, daddy, this man right here.
Ooh, I know.
He couldn't curl a toe if I put it in a tight shoe.
Right. Oh, she's going to explain that, yeah. All right, Steve, this one's from Carolyn in Greenville, Mississippi. She says, I am 62 years old, and about 9 months ago, I started dating a man that I dated in high school. We're both divorced, and he told me he was looking for a good Christian woman. We're both seeking a stronger relationship with God, but we slipped up and had sex a few times. After the first time we had sex, he told me he wants to marry me. That made me feel better about us having sex before marriage. He hasn't talked about marriage in a few months now, but he still wants sex. Do you think he brought up marriage so I would keep having sex with him? I'm too old for games.
This ain't no game. It's happened before. This ain't no game. This happened before. So this is not new. How old do you have to be before you understand that men tell you what they think you want to hear first? Then after that, then we tell you what makes us sound best next. And if you keep persisting, we'll tell you the truth. You didn't persist. You just ran up into your old guy from high school. Y'all was both divorced. Love the Lord. Want a close relationship with the Lord. And both of y'all had sex a bunch of times.
Praise him.
So, you know, y'all just in here just, you know, I don't know what y'all doing with it, but, you know, just come on now. You're too old for games. For games, he ain't bought a marriage no more. Because he don't want to get married.
Yeah. He wants sex, though, right?
We know how to give you
hope. He still wants that, yeah.
That's all it is, man.
Yeah. Thank all right. You, man. This one's from Brian in Atlanta, Steve. It says, I'm a single middle-aged man, and my best friend is a female. She has had me in the friend zone for years, but I'm in love with her. I have told her this, and she says she loves me too, but she's not in love with me. Bottom line is, she wants a man with a lot of money, and that's not me. We do everything together like we're a couple, but she won't date me. How can I show her that money is not all that matters? CLO?
I don't know how you...
That's the wrong on person CLO. To ask.
Yeah, yeah. Yes, I want to hear this answer, CLO. Yeah.
You hear this rich ass answer, me. You get
unrich.
Come on, we listen.
Problems, baby. Let's
okay.
go.
Okay, what was the question?
How can I show her? Yeah. How can I show her that money is not all that matters?
Yeah, get the show with her.
Come on.
Yeah. How old is it?
How?
He doesn't give his age. He's a middle-aged man.
Wait,
so
50?
He could be 30 to 50. Yeah.
30 is middle-aged?
30 ain't middle-aged.
Yeah, depending on when they...
Nah, he ain't middle-aged. He ain't middle-aged. See, when a man don't tell his age, he up there.
He's older.
And he trying to explain why he ain't there yet. That's why, because dudes ain't know I'm a middle-aged man and how do I, no, you 50.
Uh-uh.
So,
get
how do
to
I get
answer.
Her to, how do I get her
yeah,
to
you're fist? Stalling.
Money ain't everything.
Money's not all that matters.
It ain't. Listen to me, sir.
He's in love with her, Steve.
I know.
She wants a man with a lot of money, and that's not me, he says.
Well, you got that right.
Oh, yeah. Man.
Keep it moving.
Well, you love said it best. Be huh? That's just yeah, not man. You. And man. So, well, bro, listen to me, man. You know, man, you done had her in the friend zone. I told y'all men ain't really trying to be your friends, but, you know, you done had her in the friend. How do I get her to
show her believe that money is not that all that matters?
Money is not all that matters. Mm-hmm. Well, you're going to have to excel in the other things, brother. You're going to have to.
If you want her.
Every other thing.
Yeah, if you want
every
her.
Every other
I'm talking about, dog. You're going to have to get man. Good at every other damn thing and overshadow man. The fact. Man.
Man, I'm thinking.
Okay.
In the words of the great fight trainer, you can do it, Rock.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
Finding out a secret about someone's spouse is always a tricky situation. And one woman is now wondering whether or not she should tell her best friend the scandalous thing she just discovered about her husband. Now, Steve, this woman is from New York City. She sent us this story from the internet, and she is asking for a friend, quote, you know, those air quotes. She's asking for a friend who might be in a similar situation. A woman was recently at a prenatal doctor's appointment when she saw her best friend's husband there with a very pregnant woman. She notes, by their actions, they were definitely a couple, okay? She adds, I was shocked when I saw him, and I regret not speaking to him now, and wonders whether she should tell her best friend what she saw. Now, I know, already know what you're going to say, but what do you think this woman should do? Or have you ever caught a friend's spouse in a compromising situation?
Yeah, hell did yeah. You? But here's what probably happened. This is probably what happened.
Not just, yeah.
Uh-huh. This all this is. He took his cousin to the doctor because she needed a ride.
She was his cousin.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh. Well, yeah. Did you hear the part when I said they, by their actions, they were definitely a couple?
You can hold your cousin's hand and pat it and be supportive.
Uh-huh.
You know,
yeah,
and listen for the baby
all
to
with
kick.
Your cousin.
Well, you got to, you know, he kicking. Oh, let me hear it. Put your head on the stomach. That's probably all that was right there.
Of your cousin.
You're going to need a better lie, dog.
Yeah. Or he can just go on and just kill himself right now. them options he got. You got to sell his cousin's store, or you got to go on and start killing yourself. Because this right here.
Oh, my goodness, Steve.
Or scrape up some money and give it to his best friend so she can be quiet. Stop.
Oh. Hush money.
The payoff.
Yeah, hush money.
Okay.
Mm. You get her by $50,000 in her hand real quick.
Okay.
That's a lot. Idea. $50,000?
No, I'm talking about, don't ever say nothing ever, ever. Yeah.
Oh, so you ever, mean ever. Pay her for the rest of her life?
Her life.
As quiet as a church mouse.
Oh.
Man.
So should she tell her friend, though?
I ain't in there.
Yeah.
No, hell no. Tell your friend for what?
Because the woman was pregnant.
You saw her husband at the doctor's office with another woman.
Yeah.
Well, so y'all ladies, what would y'all do?
Well, yeah.
Oh, you know I'm a business. You know I'm a
tell. It's not my business. Nope.
You gonna tell it, Carla?
FaceTime at the doctor's office.
God, dog.
It's not my business.
As soon as I see you on your phone, I'm snatching your damn phone, running out of here.
Because you already know.
You ain't gonna be calling nobody. Not right now, you know.
If I see Carla at a doctor's office,
pull my phone out. I'm
telling. I just pull a gun out and rob the place. That's what I was doing in here.
Now you're carrying.
No, seriously, that's what I was doing in here.
You're a criminal now.
Everybody on the floor.
That's what I do. Before I let you carry this back to the house, I just robbed the place.
It's not your business. No.
Shirley, you wouldn't say anything to your friend. This is her friend.
I couldn't do it.
Her best friend.
I done seen it go bad every time, Carl.
I couldn't do it. Yeah, I just couldn't do it. It's not your business. You don't know.
Her best friend?
You don't know.
Nah, yeah, that's right.
My bestie.
I don't see what telling is going to accomplish, though.
Yeah.
Because here's the deal. Here's the truth of the matter, in all seriousness.
Okay.
You can't hide a baby.
No, you can't.
Right.
You can't hide the other family.
Mm-hmm.
Nah, man. This here comes to light.
Yeah.
And it's not necessarily, I feel, your job to bring it to light. In due time, everything will come out. But now let's just suppose. Let's take this scenario. You go to her and you tell it turns out it's nothing. And now you bought this to me to try to mess me up, tell me something about my husband.
Exactly.
You
Tommy
messy,
was right.
Girl. You
that
messy.
That will backfire on you. That
it always backfire.
If it's my best friend, that relationship that I have with my best friend, that's like a sister to me. I don't think our relationship.
Okay, let me ask
you
all a question.
Let me just say this. Your responsibility as her best friend is support her when she finds out, because she's going to find out. You're supposed to be there for her when she finds out, that shoulder to cry on.
Okay,
and I will be there.
And let me ask you another question. Here's a question for everybody, Tommy. I'm gonna start with you. Have you ever had a best friend that ain't your best friend no more?
Yep.
Carla, have you ever had a best friend that ain't your best friend no more?
No. My best friend.
Shirley, have you ever had a best friend that ain't your best friend no more?
Yes.
Yes. I have had a best friend that ain't my best friend no more. You've had a wonderful life, Carla.
What's that to do
just
with
congratulations.
Anything?
You have had a wonderful ass.
Oh, because I still have my best friend.
I'm just talking about in your life. Have you ever had a best friend? I'm talking about throughout the duration. I'm not talking about your girl Toy, because you and your girl Toy is your best friend.
Yes.
But before that, in college, you ain't have a best friend growing up. Because in college, I had a best friend.
Mm-hmm. She's been my best friend since we were 13 years old, but our moms were best friends.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So we kind of, you know what I mean?
Hold on. Let me ask you another question. Have you ever had another really good friend other than her and y'all ain't friends no more?
Absolutely.
Here we go. Uh-huh. That's what I'm talking about.
Let's get in right there.
Yeah.
Oh, shoot.
Because I understand where you're coming from. See, you may not have lost your very best friend, But all of us that have lived in this world long enough has lost what we thought was a ride or die.
Absolutely.
Yep.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
Hey, what's up, Steve Harvey Nation? We've made it to Friday. It is the middle of August. Woo, it's hot, though. Summer is winding down, but we're going to hold on to it as long as we can by enjoying a chilled, fruity, and colorful Seagram's Escapes cocktail this weekend. You know we are.
Yes, we ma'am. Love those. Listen, check this out. You can pick up the Seagram's Escapes variety pack and unwind with us. All the flavors sound as delicious as they taste. There's Jamaican Me Happy, Strawberry Daiquiri, Classic Lime Margarita, my favorite, Calypso Colada, Passion Fruit Mango, and Wild Berries, Shirley girl.
I know. And I like to mix my, you know, like put fresh fruits in there. You know how we do, Carla. We freeze them.
Yes,
Can I ask a question, please?
Yeah. Go ahead. What you got, Junior?
Can I put vodka and tequila in these? Can I do
Yes. Live your best life. Yes.
Whatever makes you feel good, do you, boo.
Yes.
These drinks are perfect for a relaxing evening at home or a lively house party with your friends. You can even add your favorite spirit. Here's your question answered, Junior, to the to create a signature cocktail. Like you can have the junior sip and see or whatever, the junior blues, whatever you want to make it, you can have all of that. Okay. You can do that. Get your Seagram's Escapes variety pack. Have a great weekend. Stay cool. And you can do that with Seagram's Escapes. I mean, I'm going to be sipping on that strawberry daiquiri and Jamaican Me Happy.
Oh, no. Yes.
All weekend.
I can see myself right now, Shirley. I can see myself when she calls. She said, "What you doing?" I'm sipping on these Junior Blues.
Yeah. Use a Calypso Colada for that. I love that, Junior. I love it.
But the way you say it, Carla, it almost sounds like you're saying Calypso Carla. I like it.
Calypso Colada. You didn't know, Nigel.
I like it. I like it a lot.
Yes.
And we can't, you know, we can't leave out the passion fruit mango. That is so delicious and refreshing. The wild berries, all of them are good. You know, I like the variety. I love the variety. Get your Seagram's Escapes variety pack and have a beautiful weekend, because guess what? Sure will, right?
Absolutely.
We sure will. And we got to give a shout out. It's back to school time. We got to give a shout out to the parents, to the educators. Mm-hmm. We love you, but the parents, we are very happy right now. So we will be sipping happiness this weekend. It's back to school.
Absolutely.
Y'all.
Yeah. It's going to sound
and the
just
grandparents,
like this.
Such as myself. Yes.
These kids going back to school. I'm so glad.
Yes, that's me. That's
as
me
I
and my girl.
My junior blues.
Do us, Junior, what we saying.
What are we doing?
These kids is going back. So I'm so glad.
Yes.
As I sip on my junior blues.
Yes. We are going to be turning up. Okay, Seagram's Escapes. Sip happiness. More of the Steve Harvey Morning Show coming up right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
We're going to pose the question. If you guys could choose which exotic animal you could communicate with, what would it be? And let's start with you, Steve.
Well, I'm going to let Tommy Jr. take a crack. Let's see where they comedy go with this.
Okay.
I'm going to let Junior have it. He's my stand-up buddy. Go ahead, Junior.
Oh, you trying to be his friend? Oh, huh?
That's my stand-up.
Because 30
well, we'll
minutes
address
ago.
That later. Yeah, thank you, Carl.
I was always the friend.
You know, my low-life ass would like to communicate with.
Y'all would beef
what, an earthworm?
Yeah. I would want to communicate with a hyena. Because I want to know what I hear in this jungle so damn funny. I really would want to know, why is we out here laughing and lions is killing everything? What I hear is funny.
I just looked at you when you said that, because I hardly ever think about those.
Yeah, no, I just be watching fights. They just be over there. What is we laughing at?
That's a good answer. That's a really good answer.
Very good, Junior.
Yeah. All right, come on, Tommy.
I think I would want to talk to an octopus.
I thought you was going to say an ass.
Oh,
See, it's getting ugly in here.
Yeah, it's on its way somewhere.
Yeah, it is.
I don't even need to explain mine, do I?
Yeah, you do. Because of all
why
the tentacles.
Why an octopus?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And all of them have little suction cups on them. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Just the conversation, you know, how you moving around the ocean, how you handling things. Mm-hmm. You know, what you sucked up today, you know.
Okay.
Yeah, stuff like that.
Yeah. All right, and we move
animals.
On.
He said,
I know.
All the damn animals in the world.
All right, come on, Steve.
That damn gorilla.
Uh-huh. I knew it.
I'm surprised.
I want to talk to a gorilla so the next time I go into a meeting, you know how they always say he was in the meeting with an 800-pound gorilla.
Yep.
Well, guess what?
Yeah.
Come on in, cheetah.
Cheetah and gorilla.
And a real gorilla walk into me. And he sit there and just be looking at people. Uh-huh. And anytime somebody say something I don't like, I wink and he knock their ass through the wall.
That's your boy.
Dog. I'm talking about, man, I have people, man, I be signing so many contracts.
Boy, that would be a different Dr. Dolittle movie with Steve as a star. Yes.
Oh, my God. No, that's funny.
Yeah.
That's funny. I can
talking
see that.
To no damn animal. Shut up, man.
No, dog. That's big.
And who told you to talk?
Steve, you could do that. Eddie Murphy did it, right? Didn't he do it?
I don't know how to do animated stuff because him and Will Smith is experts at that, talking to stuff that ain't there. You know,
yeah. Eddie had real animals in there.
That wasn't animation.
Now, I can't be in the room talking to no real animal unless it's got a chain on it.
You don't care what it is.
Oh, no, I done seen way too much happen with real animals. Uh-uh. Now, all of them got to be chained up, then Ellen gonna write in. She gonna be mad. Because I'm working with her.
Yeah, she Ellen. She saves gorillas, yeah.
Yeah.
There's been some animals that went bad before, though. You're right about that.
Mm-hmm.
Remember that panda bear that was sitting up and turned to that lady next? You remember that panda bear?
Okay, I ain't supposed to laugh at that. I'm sorry.
No.
What?
Oh. Had your ass
twisted.
So what about you, Shirley? Which animal?
I was telling people, you know, somebody asked, man, how do you stay so young? I laugh every day, and I laugh hard.
Yes.
And if you want to stay young, you have to laugh hard every day.
Yeah,
now,
man.
In order to laugh hard every day, because you're not going to hear a joke or something funny every day, you're going to have to learn how to laugh at stuff you ain't supposed to laugh at. Now, the lady got asked about that panda, damn it, I'm hollering.
Yeah, I was, too.
You don't remember that caller?
I got to look that up.
Oh, man.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
Coming up at the top of the hour, about 4 minutes after, it's my strawberry letter for today. Subject, my man treats me like an afterthought. We'll get into that. But right now, Nephew Tommy is here with today's prank phone call. What you got for us, Neff?
A small favor. That's what I want. I'd like to ask for a small favor.
Now, this sounds perfectly harmless.
Don't it?
I'm proud of you, Neff.
Just surely tell him to run it.
Okay.
Small favor.
Run it.
Run it.
Run it.
Hello?
Hello, I'm trying to reach Vicky.
This is Vicky.
Hey, Vicky, how you doing? Are you the niece of I think it's Ain't your aunt?
Yes.
Okay, and your aunt passed away. How many years ago your aunt passed?
It was about 5 years ago.
Okay, listen, I'm over here at the funeral home. My sister just passed away, and they gave me your phone number. Did you guys? We're going through a little bit of a situation here. Did you guys aunt have? You know, your aunt was a heavyset woman. Is that right?
Yes, she was.
Okay. Now they had to. Did they have to put her in a? Did they have a bill a special casket for her?
Yeah.
Okay, that's what we're kind of going through with my sister. We ordered a special casket for my sister, and I'm assuming this is the same thing that you guys went through. I've called several of her children, but I wasn't able to get in touch with anybody. But the funeral home actually had your name on file as well. So they gave me your number where I would be able to talk to you. Is that okay?
Yeah, that's okay. You can speak to me, but, you know, what seems to be the problem?
Well, listen, the funeral is actually in 2 days.
Okay.
And we ordered one of those special caskets, but it doesn't look like it's going to be in for another week. So, you know, it's almost like we're not going to have a casket for her, you know, for the funeral. And, okay. You know, like I said, the funeral home told us about, you know, that you guys were the last ones that ordered a casket of that size. And, you know, me and the rest of the family has been, you know, we've been trying to figure out what to do and what to do. Do you think it's any way possible we can borrow the casket that your aunt is in? And then when the casket comes in that we ordered, we can put her in that casket and put her back down to rest like she's always been. Do you think that's possible?
Excuse me?
Hello?
Hello? Excuse me, could you repeat yourself? What exactly are you asking me?
Well, what I'm saying is, do you think we can borrow your aunt casket? Because, you know, the funeral is in 2 days, and the casket is not going to be in order for us to be able to bury her in a casket for the, you know, to accommodate her size. That's what I'm asking.
What kind of is this you're talking about? First of all, who is this?
Okay, no, my name is Larry. Like I said, my name is Larry. I got you guys. Like I said, I tried to call some of her kids, but nobody ever picked up when I called.
Okay,
her niece's number on file too. You are her niece, Vicky, right?
Yes, I am.
Okay, well, that's what I'm saying. Do you think that maybe you can talk to the children and see if we can maybe use that particular casket?
Okay, wait a minute. What the f*** are you talking about? This some first of all, who is this? You got to be losing your mind if you think I'm going to let you dig up my auntie for just to bury your sister.
Yeah, but I understand where you're coming from, but what I'm trying to say is that we don't have a casket big enough, and they let us know that you guys were the last ones that had a casket that, you know.
What the f*** they got to do with us? That's your sister. Figure it out. Have you lost your
No. Well, okay, first of all, what I'm trying to do is this. The family been grieving pretty hard, and I just wanted to make sure that the funeral would be right. And it ain't going to be right if we don't have...
That be? We don't, how do you think my family going to feel digging my auntie up? You lost your... Man, don't call me with this... Who is the funeral home that gave you my number to ask me to use the casket so you can bury your sister? Who is the name of that person?
I can't remember, but it was the guy, the funeral director let me know that you guys had went through a situation where you had to bury your aunt. Like I said,
and
I tried to call.
And what's your name again?
My name is Larry.
Okay, Larry, this is a stupid. I don't know what gave you my phone number to call me asking you this dumb. Can you believe this? They call here asking me so can they dig up a so they can bury their sister. It's not fault that his sister don't have a casket. Hello?
I understand it's not your fault. What I'm trying to say is would y'all show some sympathy and some love for what me and my family going through, because we don't have a casket. Like I say, my sister was a heavy set woman.
That's all fine and good. You know, my condolences go out to you and your family. You know, I'm trying to be as reserved as I can with this whole situation. But do you understand what kind of stupid you're asking me right now to actually dig up my aunt who's been in the ground for 5 years to bury your sister?
Okay, but Vicky, let me ask you this, though. If we use it, your aunt ain't gonna know. She ain't gonna know we use it.
What kind of stupid is for you to say to me? My aunt and I, we don't know. Are you stupid? What kind of are you talking? Are you smoking crack? We don't know. She not ground no more.
First of all, you know what? I appreciate you trying to work with me, but I want to say this. You don't even have the authority to make that decision. If you give me one of the numbers to one of your cousins,
because I was really trying to be nice and be calm. But guess what? We're not doing this stupid. I'm trying to be nice to you and try to help you out, but no, you want me to get ignorant and act stupid with you. I was trying to be nice and sympathetic, but we're not doing it. I'm not giving you the number. I got the authority to tell you right now, no, we're not digging her up so you can bury your sister. Figure it out.
Okay, so that's just it? I can't talk to now?
Yeah,
one of
that's it. No, you ain't talking to nobody. You talking to me,
okay, I got something else I need to tell you, though. I need to tell you something else. Are you listening?
To tell me.
I want to tell you this. This is Nephew Tommy from the Steve Harvey Morning Show. Vicky, your sister Sheila got me to prank phone call you.
Hold up. Who is this again?
Vicky, this is Nephew Tommy from the Steve Harvey Morning Show. Your sister Sheila got me to prank phone call you.
Oh, y'all. So you got me over here all worked up. I'm cussing. I'm going to kick she play too much. She ain't got to do.
Vicky, I got one more thing to ask you, baby. What is the baddest, and I mean the baddest, radio show in the land?
The Steve Harvey Morning Show. For y'all crazy.
it's just a small favor.
Oh, my
you see what I'm saying?
Too much, Tommy.
Huh?
Ain't nobody finna dig nobody up for
yes,
you.
Thank you.
Use they casket, dog.
Hey, dog, the casket is perfect for my sister that just passed. You know what I'm saying?
Makes sense. It's perfect. Why should you just use it once? Why? All that money for one time?
There you go, Jay.
Team Tommy, baby. Team Tommy.
You know what I'm saying? Why should a casket only be used once?
Yeah.
Why? The person
the
is
body
gone.
That was already in the casket. What happened to that body?
But they gone.
That's how about we just do that for show and so then we sell it again.
Yeah, and if you borrow it, are you going to give it back?
You have any idea what that thing gonna smell like? When you're talking about?
They ain't thought about it.
Someone with some sense, please.
I can't tell him it jumped to her desk.
We're gonna get them ashes out of there.
Stupid keeps rolling. Stupid is rolling this weekend, and Stupid is rolling right into West Palm Beach, Florida at the Improv. That's the 22nd, 23rd, and 24th, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday night. Get your tickets. They on sale right now and laying in the cut. Arlington Improv, February 28th. That is Thursday night, and then February, and then March 1st and 2nd, the Nephew will be in Arlington Improv, Dallas, Texas. Get your tickets. They on sale right now.
All right. Thank you, Nephew. Jesus. All right. Coming up next, Strawberry Letter. Subject, my man treats me like an afterthought. We'll get into it right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
Time now for today's Strawberry Letter. And if you need advice on relationships, dating, work, sex, parenting, and more, please submit your Strawberry Letter to Steve Harvey FM and click Submit Strawberry Letter. We could be reading your letter live on the air, just like we're going to read this one right here, right now.
Buckle up. Hold on tight. We got it for you. Here it is. Strawberry Letter.
Thank you, Nephew. Subject, my man treats me like an afterthought. Dear Steve and Shirley, I've been in a relationship for almost 2 years. And when I think about the things this man has shown me sexually and mentally, I am floored. He literally takes my breath away. But there are a few problems with our relationship. We've never spent a night together, and I've never met his family, except for his twin daughters and their mother. What? Except for his twin daughters and their mother. It was a quick hi and bye when we ran into them at Target. We were not together on our 1 year anniversary because of his job. You got it now. I didn't see him on Valentine's Day because he had his daughters that night. I saw him the next day and he gave me flowers. His birthday is 3 days before Christmas, but I didn't see him until Christmas Eve because his grandparents were in town. There was nothing on Christmas Day, and he went to church for New Year's Eve without me. Then he came over for a few hours on New Year's Day to make up for it. I don't discuss how I feel about things for fear of running him off because he told me his ex-girlfriend nagged him a lot. He is always busy. If I ask to see him, but when he calls me, I will drop everything to be with him. I don't know why he's acting this way, and I pray it's not what my subconscious is telling me it is. In his defense, he does work extreme hours. He has his kids every other weekend, and he likes to chill with his boys to unwind. I offered to cook dinner at his house so we could have a heart-to-heart, and he said he still needs to buy furniture and fix his place up before I can come over. I need him to make me a priority in his life. How can I get this through to him? Has our relationship run its course? He'll never make you a priority. He'll never do that because guess what? He already has a priority in his life. Okay, he has a priority. You should have entitled this letter for 2 years. I've been in a relationship with a married man, because that's what it is. I mean, think about it. You never, ever get holidays. You don't get Christmas. You don't even get his birthday, which is 3 days before Christmas. You don't get New Year's Eve. You don't get New Year's Day. Well, you get a couple of hours when he decides to come over. You don't get Valentine's Day. That's the day for lovers. You don't get anything. And he played you so hard. He told you his ex-girlfriend nagged a lot, so now you're scared. You said you're scared of running him off. You're scared to tell him how you feel and what all of this means to you and why doesn't he spend more time with you and what's going on. You're scared to bring up how you feel. He puts you off. He's always too busy for you. He's got the kids every other weekend or he's going out with his boys. You can't even go over his house because he doesn't have any furniture, really? And you make excuses for him at every turn. You have to stop this. Talking about in his defense, he's very busy. Yeah, busy with his wife and family running away from you. You have to stop all of this. You got to stop seeing him. You have to stop answering his calls, stop calling him, stop everything, all of the above, because you already know what's going on. You said it. Your subconscious, you don't want it to be what your subconscious is telling you that it is. Well, that's what it is. Listen to your self-conscious, all right? Please, please don't be stupid on this. I mean, get yourself together. Listen to your head and not your heart in this situation. The man has a wife. Steve?
I just, wow.
I know. How long have we been doing these letters?
Yeah. How obvious does it have to be?
Yeah.
How many times have we given advice on this subject right here? You say, my man treats me like an afterthought. That's cause that's what you are. See, you solved the answers in the letter. I've been in a relationship for 2 years, and now hear the glory of it. When I think about the thing this man has shown me sexually and mentally, I'm floored. What? Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk about what he done showed you. We don't know what he's doing sexually, but obviously you sprung. He literally takes my breath away. Now here go the letter. We got some problems, though. We've never spent a night together. And I've never met his family. What?
2 years.
2 years and you ain't been over his house. And later on in the letter, it say, because he ain't got no furniture.
Right.
Who it take 2 years to get a couch?
2 years to make get a couch?
Who done got this place and in 2 years ain't got a couch, ain't got no damn bed, ain't got a TV. Who been at their house for 2 years without no damn cable and somewhere to sit?
I don't know.
Where do he eat when he at home?
Yeah.
What do you mean he don't have furniture? Listen to me. And I've never met his family except for his twin daughters and their mother, and it was a quick high and by. We ran into them in Target. That was an accident. That was a damn accident. He damn sure wasn't intending for you to meet them then, but you did. We were not together on our 1 year anniversary. That's cause y'all don't have anniversaries. What is you making up? Y'all don't have anniversaries. Because of his job, I didn't see him on Valentine's Day. That's cause you ain't his Valentine. I'ma just give it to you. Cause he had his daughters that night. Who spend Valentine's with their damn kids?
Right.
We're supposed to be having sex on Valentine's Day. What is your kids in here for? Get your ass away from the door.
Crazy.
I got the rest of it for you when I come back.
I know you do, Steve.
I'm not even pulling no punches with this.
Please don't.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
All right, Steve, come on. Let's recap today's strawberry letter. My man treats me like an afterthought.
Well, that's because you are, and it's all in the damn letter. Other than when y'all having this crazy-ass sex where you done learned so much, you on the flow. So now.
Yeah.
He literally takes my breath away. But then we got some problems. She ain't never spent a night at the man's house.
Mm.
2 years. Why? Because he say he don't have no furniture yet. My question is, who ain't bought a couch in 2 years?
I don't know, Steve. I do not know.
Where do he eat when he at home?
He just stand in the middle of the floor with some containers. I've never met his family except for his twin daughters and their mother, and it was a real quick high and by. We ran into them at Target. That was a damn accident.
Oh, yeah.
We were not together on our one-year anniversary. That's because y'all don't have anniversaries. I'm just going over what I went over, and then I'm going to get to the rest of it. Because of his job, I didn't see him on Valentine's Day. No, that ain't because his job. It's because you didn't see him on Valentine's Day because you ain't his Valentine. Because he had his daughters that night. Who the hell spend Valentine's night with their kid? Even if it's my week of custody, somebody finna watch their ass on Valentine's night. Because I got to go see somebody naked with a diaper on with a bow and arrow. Cupid.
Cupid.
I done played Cupid on Valentine's Day. I done jumped out the closet with a diaper on.
Oh. Yeah. You never told me.
That was a long time ago. Y'all ain't know me then. I was young. I had the body for that diaper. I saw him the next day and he gave me flowers. You know why you got flowers? Because he spent all the money on the purse and the candy on the other girl. And anybody can give you flowers. That's just stop. They sell them on the corner. His birthday is 3 days before Christmas, but I didn't see him until Christmas Eve because his grandparents was in town.
Wow.
Who need 4 days with some old ass people to say Merry Christmas? Who need 4 damn days with some old people to say Merry Christmas? Then there was nothing on Christmas Day. Oh, no. That's where you're wrong. Oh, Christmas Day was popping.
It was lit.
It was jolly.
Kids, family, woman. Christmas was lit. It just wasn't with you. Because who can leave their house on Christmas Day? And why would he not come over to your house on Christmas Day? He ain't got no damn furniture. He ain't even got no nothing to sit on and look at the damn lights on the tree. Everybody like putting their tree up, getting a cup of coffee or some hot chocolate, looking at the tree and daydreaming and having fun. That's the purpose of a tree.
Christmas magic, yeah.
Yeah. That was nothing on Christmas Day. And he went to church on New Year's Eve without me. That man was not in church on New Year's Eve. He was just without you. He told you he went to church on New Year's Eve. His ass ain't go to church on New Year's Eve. Then he came over for a few hours on New Year's Day to make up for it. Oh, I bet that's when y'all was in the flow having some of that mind-blowing sex. Mm. I don't discuss how I feel about things for fear of running him off because he told me his ex-girlfriend nagged him a lot. You know why? Because she was trying to figure out, how the hell you don't come over here? Because he ain't had no furniture in this apartment for about 8 years.
Oh, really?
She worried his ass to death about coming over, and she had never spent the night over there. Mm-hmm. Okay, he's always busy if I ask to see him, but when he calls me, I drop everything. I don't know why he's acting this way.
What?
You've been with him 2 years and you don't know why he's acting this way. He can't act no other way. He got a family. He can't act no other way. I pray it's not what my suspicion is telling me it is. Stop praying for something God gives you to protect you. You have this thing called intuition. It's telling you, now you want to call it your subconscious. I'm praying it's not what my subconscious is telling me. It's your intuition, and it is telling you that, and God gives it to women to protect them. And all of women out there listening know, every time they go against what their intuition tells them, they pay for it. Every woman has done it.
True.
Now, in his defense, he does work extreme hours. What is he, a forest fighter?
Come on, for real.
What job he got where he worked extreme hours? What is he in the UFC? He a cage fighter. What is extreme hours? So he don't get no time. He working all these hours and still can't buy no damn couch and bed. But he worked extreme hours.
That's right,
Steve. Still ain't bought no damn
A protest
furniture.
Officer.
That's right.
He has his kids every other weekend, and he likes to chill with his boys to unwind. I like chill with my boys to unwind, too. But I'd rather be somewhere having sex. What are you talking about? I want to cook dinner at his house. He can't have you over there. Somebody over there already cooking. And they're not going to understand you coming over because that's their kitchen.
Right. Mm-hmm. All right,
Steve. I need him to make me a priority in his life. He's not. How can I get through to him? You can't. Is our relationship run its course? You have no relationship. Mm-mm. That's the strawberry letter.
All right. Thank you, Steve. Post your comments on today's Strawberry Letter at Steve Harvey FM on Instagram and Facebook. And please don't forget to check out the Strawberry Letter podcast on demand.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
Come on, Junior, with truth be told.
Oh, my God.
You got a good one?
Oh, my God. Do I? Oh, my
You're
God.
You're all selfish.
Oh, my God. Listen, Shirley, I'm so happy right now. I really am. Tell me, because truth be told, I'm tall.
Oh, God.
That's your truth
I didn't make it.
Not tall.
No, man. I'm tall. I don't need no help getting nothing off the counter. Now, all of us on this show can't say that. No, some of us have to go get the stepladder on the side of the refrigerator to get up there. I don't have to do that.
You let three people make you think you're tall.
I am
you're not tall.
I'm in there. Let me tell you, that's the most tall stuff I do. Stuff at the top of the closet, like
that.
Shoes, I get that.
You can get that. Huh?
I get that, no problem. I ain't got no problem getting none of that. Everybody on screwing in light bulbs, no problem. I'm
You're
tall.
Not tall.
I can do that. Now, everybody on this show, 95% of us.
I can put a light bulb
95%
in, boy.
Of us can do that. Not 100%, but 95% is good. I'm just saying. I like getting stuff out the freezer at the top.
Yes.
I can do that. Yeah. I can go in there and get a pack of meat out the top of the fridge.
I can get Junior. Meat out of a
pack of meat.
What's up,
Tommy can put a light bulb in.
Easy
you.
Bake oven.
And, I know it's in the ceiling.
It ain't one in the ceiling.
It just had to be a nightlight.
A
plug in nightlight.
It got to go in at the bottom. But then he got to get up here where I am. Tommy, like, man, don't worry about that. I got tall shoulders for you to stand on if you need help. And I love you, man, with your little short behind. You all right?
Shut up.
No. You made a mistake. His behind ain't short. That's the tallest thing on
it. Well, can he get in the tall club now?
I ain't gonna do this with y'all.
Can he get in the tall club
he
now?
He got tall ass.
Those little legs.
Man. Little hunchback of Notre Dame booty.
Yeah.
He
was a little short with us doing that segment,
he
wasn't
was. Uh-huh. He was. You know, man, don't worry about something. One day, Tommy. One day, man. One day.
Okay.
I think one day, man.
You know, they sell these things you can put in the shoes and make you, you know, the insole.
Oh, lifts.
Lifts.
Oh, lifts.
Yeah, yeah, it give you like a couple inches, actually.
Still short.
Then a couple more inches. Oh,
you
man.
Get 2 inches, you still short. I lose 2 inches, I'm still tall.
Yeah, you put those in the shoe, but your heel is sticking out the back of your shoe. It looks real.
Yeah.
Man, your shoe about to come off.
Keep walking.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
You guys already know, but sometimes honesty isn't the best policy. Here's a situation or question that we found on Facebook, and this one is from Jerry. Jerry says, when my wife comes home from getting her hair done and colored, it doesn't look great, but I always tell her it does, always, okay? Any married man should know this. No matter what, tell her she looks beautiful. So when do you feel like honesty isn't the best policy? All the time?
I've not
all the time that way.
I've been under
the hottest look on me. Yeah. Just lie, man. Just lie.
Yeah. Junior, I've been under oath and lie.
What'd you say?
Because I've been under oath and lie.
In the court?
Yeah. I've had to.
What?
I was going to lose.
Perjured yourself?
Perjured. I was trying to save myself.
From what?
I already know if I tell the truth what's going to happen. So why not try this lie?
You put your hand on the Bible and still lie?
That's not a real Bible, Shirley. And the people that's in there trying to get me is not religious people.
Oh, okay.
Everybody in that line, the prosecutor line.
Fair game.
Everybody in that line. I ain't even put my hand on no Bible and then hold me to that.
Have you lied, Shirley, in a relationship?
Yeah.
When last time you lied to your husband?
It's been a while. You know, I'm not, I don't really lie, but.
When the last time you lied to your wife, Tommy?
This morning, when she called. What?
Yeah. Perfectly comfortable with that answer.
Yeah, this morning.
Now that was an honest answer from you. When what about you, Steve? Yeah.
Last time you.
Well, she out of town right now, so. I'm anticipating as soon as I'm anticipating as soon as she called.
Exactly.
But why do you guys lie when the truth will be just fine? I don't get that part.
No, don't say that. No, it's not the truth will be just fine.
The truth will be fine. Yes.
90% of the time, the truth is not fine.
Okay, what is she gonna ask you that you have to lie about this
morning? All right, I'll tell you what. Ask me something. Let's just practice. Let's go.
All right,
do several of
them. Hey, hi, honey. Is it raining there?
About to, seem like.
Why you ask about the rain?
Now I got to. Is it raining there? Because now what I got to send you. In the mail. No. Go ahead, Shirley. Ask me something else.
What are you doing today? What are you going to do today? Like after work? I know you have to work, but like after
working
work.
All day, baby. I'm going to work all the way till it's time to go to bed. I ain't got no breaks.
Yeah. No breaks? Because I was thinking about coming down and maybe we could have lunch together.
No, we ain't having lunch today because we got cases is backed up for COVID.
What did you wear to work today? Did Ellie pick something out for you to wear?
No, I just put on something myself. Just got on a sweatsuit. That's all.
Well, I saw you posted something and it had Ellie's name under it.
Yeah, it was a picture from last week. You know, I don't post nothing no damn way, so that picture just from last week.
Well, have you been on Instagram lately?
Instagram?
Social media, yeah. Have you been on Instagram lately?
When did they start that?
See, right
Insta,
there.
What you say? What did you call
it? You don't have
Insta?
To lie.
You know, just that just gets, she just be going, your black ass. If you don't buy Steve.
What are you lying about Instagram for?
I don't know. Just practicing. What? Just got to stay sharp.
Whoa.
Yeah.
All right. Listen.
Instagram. When did they start that?
We'll have more of the Steve Harvey Morning Show coming up in 20 minutes right after this. I work with a bunch of liars.
Yeah.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
All right, guys. Before we left for break, we were talking about lying. When isn't it a good time to lie? But you guys lie regardless. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, and I'll tell you why I lie regardless.
Why?
Because
I don't get that.
If you tell a woman the truth, they're going to expect it all the time.
Yes.
Thank you, huh?
And then, Shirley.
Manage her expectations.
Yeah, and then what happens was when I do tell the truth, and then she don't believe me. And I pick those moments where I will tell you the truth. But there's very few. And then when you assume that's a lie, then I jump out and prove that it was the truth. And then I'm good for another year. See, damn, every time I tell you something, you think I'm lying. Then I tell you the truth. Now look at this right here.
Yeah.
Damn, baby.
Yeah.
Now that allows me to lie for another year.
I love it.
Yeah, you see what I'm saying? You see that, Shirley? That's how that works.
I see it, but, you know, whatever with that, all those lies.
Okay. Lying keeps us together.
Yeah. Ain't you still with your husband after all these years?
Yeah.
Thank the Lord he been lying. Yes.
Yeah. So, but you're saying all men lie. That's what you're saying.
I'm saying what?
You're saying all men lie.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Coming up in 33 minutes after the hour, we'll try to get the truth out of you when we play a round of Would You Rather right after this.
All right.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
Time now for Would You Rather. Would you rather let your boss see your full internet history, or would you rather let your spouse see your full internet history?
Oh, yeah, the boss. Sure. Come on,
yeah.
Boss.
Yeah, my boss.
I let Steve see this all
day. Yeah,
right.
He see this all day.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
And he won't fire you? And he won't fire you?
Hell no.
I might get a raise out the deal if I do it right.
You might get a raise.
It made me proud.
Yeah. All right, boss, all day. All right, would you rather lose a finger or have a headache every day for the rest of your life?
No, I'm going to take this damn finger. No, that headache, I got to do that.
Yeah, I mean,
but take that ring finger on the right hand. Mm-hmm. You know, the ring finger on the left hand? Just give me the ring finger on the right hand because I'm left-handed.
Yeah.
And that finger, I don't need that finger to button my shirt or nothing, zip up my pants. That finger kind of useless. I'm going to need that thumb, though.
You need them thumbs, though.
Yeah.
You need that thumb.
You ain't going to be able to hold a knife without that thumb, without looking like a caveman.
Yeah.
All right, would you rather?
It's hard to button your shirt with both your index fingers. I'm going to tell you that right now.
Kind of need the thumb. All right.
Picking up french fries is going to look a little crazy, like you smoking a cigarette.
Yeah.
Would you rather be trapped on a desert island with someone who never speaks, never talks to you, or would you rather be trapped on a desert island with someone who never shuts up?
Hey.
Quiet all the time?
No.
Hey.
No, you're going to get tired of that. That talking gonna drive you crazy, but I'd rather have the talker.
Yeah.
You'd rather have the talker.
That Junior, silence would kill me.
Junior, you want someone who talks all the
talking
time?
I don't need to talk to me. We talk every morning. I don't want to talk all the time.
Okay. So you want someone who's quiet. Yeah. What about you?
You never shut up.
Oh, no, I want the person to talk all the time. I know how to cut. I know how to shut people out anyway.
How do that.
You can be talking your ass off to me, man. I just look right at you and be looking right through the back of your head.
Do you hear me? I know you hear me. You're looking right at me.
And make them think I'm looking at them, but I be looking at something right off to the side of your head.
Answer me.
You know, like a bush or something, and you be talking your ass off.
It ain't nothing major.
I don't even know you talking to me.
All right, that's today's round, guys, of Would You Rather. Now, coming up at 49 minutes after the hour, it is our last break of the day. And, of course, we'll have some closing remarks from the one and only Steve Harvey right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
All right, here we are, last break of the day. Time for Steve's closing remarks.
Okay, today, Tommy sent me something. Sent me a caption that I'm going to keep. Because I oftentimes keep quotes in my motivational folder, in my photo stream. And I just look at them from time to time when I'm feeling a certain kind of way. Sometimes I just need a little uplift myself, you know. And Tommy sent me this today. And I'm going to share it with you. And it's going to cause me to expound on it a bit because it's something I really do believe in. It says, "Do not ask God to guide your footsteps if you're not willing to move your feet. Do not ask God to guide your footsteps if you're not willing to move your feet." You know, folks, it's very simple. God can put his finger on something to bless if you give him something to put his finger on. But you can't ask God to do something and you're making no effort. Lord, help me get a job, but you ain't putting in no applications. Lord, help me do right, but all you ever want to do is wrong. You just committed to wrong.
you know, you got to make a move in the right direction. You know, faith without works is dead. So what Tommy sent me, do not ask God to guide your footsteps if you're not willing to move your feet, is something all of us, and all of us are guilty of it from time to time. Sometimes we get complacent. Sometimes we just get to feeling sorry for ourselves. You know, oh man, I guess it ain't meant to be. Oh Lord, what now? You know, look, man, you can complain your way through life if you want to, but you really have to make an attitude adjustment. You got to get two things moving, your attitude and your feet. Those two things have to get moving. You got to start taking steps. You may not know the way how to get to the finish line, but the finish line is somewhere. It ain't where you at. The finish line is never where you're standing. So you got to start taking some steps. And once again, you may not know all the steps necessary to get to the tape, but you got to start the process, man. So like the caption says, stop asking God to guide your footsteps if you ain't willing to move your feet. You got to put it into motion. Look, it's just a dream when you're thinking about it. But you got to put your dreams to work. Motivation is when your dreams put on work clothes. You got to take your dreams and put work clothes on them, man. You got to start stepping in the right direction. You've got to make a move towards the light. You've got to step towards the finish line. You've got to start to get to where you're trying to get to. You got to get to go. You got to go to get. Period. You cannot stay that wherever you're trying to get to can't be right where you at. It can't be. It can't be. I give you, look, this is a silly example. But let's say your family reunion is in Wyoming, which I know it's not. That's why I said it. And you drive to Wyoming. When you get to Wyoming and you reach Wyoming, the state of Wyoming, you still got to do something. Because where is the family reunion at? You just can't go to Wyoming. Well, I'm here, Lord. You here, you well. You even when you get to where you say you're going, you got to move around. Let's say you get to the park where you're holding the family reunion. And you get to the park. Once you get to the park, what? You got to do something? You're going to play softball, volleyball. You're going to sit on the tree, play domino. You're going to barbecue. You're going to make lemonade. You constantly got to be doing something. There is no when you get there, you there, and there is no more movement required. There's movement required throughout your life. Because wherever you're trying to get to, it ain't where you at. I can promise you that. It's never where you at. I'm doing very well in my life. It ain't where I'm going. How would I be just, I'm here now, this it. This it. What? No more dreams, Steve. No more visions. You want nothing else. You here. This it for you. And it doesn't matter to me that people look at me and go, man, you got all this. I don't even see what you tripping for. I ain't tripping. I just want to be more than I am. I'm really trying to be a better person. I really, really am. I'm not content with the person I am. I could improve. I could actually be a better person. So I'm in the process. God ain't through with me yet. He's working on me. I'm trying. I'm better than I used to be. But I'm still got my feet moving. So I'm asking God to guide my steps. But I got my feet moving, man. Stop asking God to guide your footsteps if you ain't willing to move your feet. Can't happen. It's what you want. Come on, man. Stop that. You're being unreasonable to God. Guiding your footsteps and moving your feet down the path, that's two different things. You got to do that. You make one step, he'll make two. So if you don't make the one, you cannot expect him to make the two. He can touch you and bless you, but you got to give him something to bless. You got to do something. Can't sit at the house watching TV. That's it. Stop asking God to guide your footsteps if you're not willing to move your feet. Thank you, Tommy. That was my closing remark.
Drop it.
Okay.
Drop the mic.
Boom.
Now that actually sounded like a mic.
That was encouraging. Yeah.
All right, y'all. Y'all have a good one. Have a great weekend, too. I'll be working.
For all Steve Harvey contests, no purchase necessary, void where prohibited. Participants must be legal U.S. residents at least 18 years old unless otherwise stated. For complete contest rules, visit SteveHarveyFM.com.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.